This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
What's at the top of the lane of the Derby? Peace Rules in front by a neck. The Funny Side on the outside second. Empire Maker makes his move on the far outside, and here he comes, and they turn for home. Empire Maker set down by Bailey. Peace Rules digs in along the inside. Funny Side in between the top pair. Funny Side has got a head in front. Peace Rules full bore on the inside. Empire Maker far outside. It's Peace Funny Side just in front. Peace Rules on the inside, and Empire Maker, Funny Side looking to upset the Derby. Funny Side at 12-1 wins it by a length and three quarters.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Down the Stretch. I'm Mark Asano. On this morning's Derby Day show, we'll begin with a look back at the Oaks, then a look ahead to the Derby, minus another talented runner. We'll welcome in a pair of special guests this morning, Schenectady's Don Lucarelli, whose Starlight Racing partners have both Intense Holiday and General A-Rod going in the Derby. Then a bit later on, Mr. Billy Gowan, who has completely bucked the odds. A man with a three-horse stable has a starter in the Kentucky Derby in Ride on Curlin. We will have complete analysis and selections for the 140th Derby as well. So all of that and much, much more if you stay with us for this, our May 3rd edition of the program, which is being sponsored by Parting Glass Racing, Saratoga's original racing partnership. Visit them on the web at partingglassracing.com. Good morning once again. Happy Derby Day. Big show in front of us, so settle in, relax. We'll try to get you prepared for America's greatest race. Not a particularly happy Derby Day for the Connections of Hopportunity. The winner of the Rebel Stakes and second behind California Chrome in the Santa Anita Derby and last has become another Kentucky Derby casualty. His trainer, Bob Baffert, announced on Thursday morning that Hopportunity had been withdrawn from the Derby due to a bruise on his left front foot. It's hopeful that the injury is minor, but it obviously happened at the most inopportune time. I liked Hopportunity quite a bit. He was going to be my selection to win the Derby. I thought he was sitting on the big race. This year's Derby has become a race of attrition. Who's left standing? Here's a look again, we used this page last week, at some of the very talented members of this three-year-old crop who didn't make, for various reasons, today's Derby. Now, it's still America's greatest race, but this year's edition, I think, has been weakened greatly by the absence of these runners. Folks, you could make a heck of a horse race out of those, what is it, 13 that you see there. Now also eligible Pablo Del Monte has been scratched by his connections because of the extreme outside post. Now that's kind of unusual because when they entered, they knew if fortunate enough to draw in, they would be getting the extreme outside post. This is no surprise. And supposedly, it cost them $25,000 to enter. Very unusual. With the scratch of number 11 Hopportunity, what's going to happen with the starting gate? Runners 1 through 10 will move out a post position. Now, the saddle cloth numbers will remain the same, and you're going to be betting on the saddle cloth numbers. But for instance, number 1, Vickers in Trouble, will actually break from post position 2, which is a benefit to him because post 1, it's a little dog leg, you have to break out. So runners 1 through 10 will each move out a stall. All right. Yesterday, 140th renewal of the Kentucky Oaks, 12 three-year-old fillies with a gate scratch of Empress of Midway, mile and an eighth for $1 million, and number 13 Untappable. Very impressive in both of her starts this year at the fairgrounds, was the even money favorite. For the call of the Kentucky Oaks, here's Larry Colmus.
They're off in the Kentucky Oaks. And it was a slow start for Fashion Plate. And there goes Sugar Shock, right out to take the early lead. It's Sugar Shock to the front. And My Miss Sophia is right up and on the pace, and Untappable is there too. Thank You Mary Lou settles back, running in fourth, and now takes third. Untappable is fourth to the outside, and they're followed by Aurelia's Bell, and right alongside of her is Unbridled Forever as they race on that first turn. In behind them, Maria Antonia, Kiss Moon to the outside, a break of another two to Please Explain. And then we come back to Rosalind, who is third last early on, just ahead of Got Lucky. And at the back of the field, it's Fashion Plate. They went 23-3 for the opening quarter mile, and Sugar Shock leads the way up the back stretch. With My Miss Sophia pressing the pace on the outside, second, Thank You Mary Lou is third. Untappable is just off the leader. She's three lengths behind at this stage. Then comes Rhea Antonia to the outside of Unbridled Forever, while Aurelia's Bell rides the rail five lengths off the lead. And then it's back to Kiss Moon. Please Explain. Rosalind is moving up on the far outside. She's got six lengths to make up. And it's a long way back to Got Lucky as they round the far turn. And last of them all is Fashion Plate. 47-4 for a half mile. Around the far turn they go. And now there goes My Miss Sophia to the front. But Untappable is right at her neck on the outside. And these two turn for home together in the Kentucky Oaks. And Untappable and Rosie Napravnik have taken the lead. My Miss Sophia tries her best to stick with her. But Untappable is moving away. She's three lengths out in front of My Miss Sophia. As they come down to the final 16th, it's Untappable. Untappable is well clear. She is unstoppable. She is uncatchable. She is untappable.
Untappable. Steve Asmussen, Rosie Napravnik's second Oaks win in the last 3 years, makes even money look like a bargain as she draws away from My Miss Sophia to win the Kentucky Oaks by 4.5 lengths. Unbridled Forever finished a distant third, with Rosalind fourth. Untappable, who was a little hot coming out of the paddock, was perfectly relaxed during the run. She got into that rhythmic stride and really never had an anxious moment. Considering everything that's been going on, it's a huge win for Steve Asmussen and for Ron Winchell, one of the owners who stuck with a beleaguered trainer. Minute 48.68, the second fastest in the history of the Oaks in front of 113,000. Here's a look at the Kentucky Oaks Kentucky Derby daily double payoffs. These are in $2 increments, with number 13 Untappable, who paid $4. The smallest double, of course, with number 5 California Chrome at 1140. Second smallest double with number 20 Wicked Strong at 39.60. The third lowest double with number 4 Danza at 44.60. And the fourth lowest double with number 16 Intense Holiday at 58.40. The largest double with number 2 Harry's Holiday just 20 cents shy of $400. And the interesting thing about that is Harry's Holiday is only 35-1 overnight. So that's obviously a lot more than the parlay. But there's a look at the Oaks Derby double payoffs. And we are up to our first break. When we return, Don Lucarelli will join us. As we go to this break, I decided we were going to do something different this year. We were going to show some different Kentucky Derbies of the past going to the internal breaks. We've kind of shown the same ones over the years. Well, we're going to begin with 2006, a 20-horse field, the 5.5-1 favorite, number 11, Sweet Northern Saint. So we will take a look at the 2006 Derby to the break, back with Don Lucarelli right after these messages.
They're in the gate. Off and running in Derby 132. Very fast start for Sinister Minister. Straight out to take the lead, joined by Sharp Humor on the outside and Keyed Entry on the Muscle, and charging up along the inside. Behind that comes Showing Up, and Barbaro's up close early, just 2.5 lengths off the place. Bluegrass Cat looks for a position along the inside fence as they pass the stands. The Twin Spires for the first time, and Keyed Entry keyed up along the inside and neck in front, joined by Sinister Minister. They're going quickly up front by 2.5 lengths to the opening quarter mile down the straightaway in 22 3/5 seconds. It's Keyed Entry leading the way under Pat Valenzuela, length in front now of Sinister Minister, tracks from second now, and behind that Showing Up and Barbaro, they're stride for stride, third and fourth. Bluegrass Cat tucked in on the inside, Sharp Humor three wide to the outside now. Seaside Retreat is 7 lengths off the pace and tugging his way through between horses. Lawyer Ron in heavy traffic, Sweet Northern Saints making up good headway up the inside, making ground. Point Determined follows him up into stride. Bob and John, 8 lengths off the pace at this point, followed up on the outside by Brother Derek. He's got 9 lengths to make up now. Then up the inside, Steppenwolfer gains ground along the inside fence, followed up 3 wide by Flashy Bull. And behind that, Jazzle is second last, and at the back of the pack, Cause to Believe, the trailer, 6 furlongs in 1, 10, and 4. Around the far turn they go, and it's Keyed Entry in front by a head. Sinister Minister makes his move and pounces on him. Here comes Barbaro, and he's charging hard to the outside, Showing Up and with a fighting chance. Sweet Northern Saint just looking for a seam up the inside. Point Determined and striking range as well at the top of the lane, and they turn for home in the Kentucky Derby. Barbaro comes roaring off the turn, opens up by 3 with 3/16 to run now. His entry made up the inside, Showing Up still in the second spot, joined by Bluegrass Cat, who's plugging away down to the final furlong though, and it's all Barbaro. Barbaro in front by 5. Very impressive. Barbaro and Edgar Prado rolling on to win Kentucky Derby 132. He won it by 6 lengths over Bluegrass Cat. Steppenwolfer was third. Very tight photo for fourth. And the time was 2:01 and 4.
This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Missed one of our TV shows? No worries. Now you can catch all your favorite programs online. Simply log on to CapitalOTB.com and click on the YouTube link at the bottom of the homepage. And look for our new podcast coming soon. CapitalOTB.com. Log on today.
Welcome back to Down the Stretch, everyone. I'm Mark Asano, and Barbaro for Michael Matz and Edgar Prado dominated 8 years ago, winning by 6.5 lengths over Bluegrass Cat and Steppenwolfer. Our first guest this morning is the co-managing partner of Starlight Racing, who later this afternoon in the Derby will be represented by both Intense Holiday and General A-Rod. We welcome in live via telephone from Louisville, Schenectady's Don Lucarelli. Donnie Marcassano welcoming you back to Down the Stretch.
Good morning, Mark.
Nice to have you.
Glad to be here.
Donnie, this is your fourth Derby. Is it still as exciting as the very first one? What are your emotions this morning?
Well, the first one, I think, going into it the week of, it was definitely a lot more emotional for me, not knowing what's to come and, what the possibilities are. And so definitely the first one was the most exciting on the week, during the week of. But no problem handling that stuff this time around. It's just, I know what's going to happen, when we go walk the horse over, you realize, and then when they start playing that song, My Old Kentucky Home, it's, it's all over. I mean, you really feel it, so.
And Donnie, does it feel a bit different this year? Because, let's face it, to be candid, in the past with horses like Keyed Entry and Manba and Sam P, you really didn't have much of a realistic chance. That's different this year with Intense Holiday.
Yes. I mean, you say you have to be in it to win it, and you're hoping that you're the one that gets the trip when you're, a huge underdog like we were in those instances. But the exciting part about this one is the fact that Intense Holiday has really flourished ever since he's gotten there from Palmetto's. I mean, it's just unbelievable the way he's doing up here. And it's all going to come down to, no matter what the statistics are, you know, he has the best dosage in the race. It's all going to come down to getting that clean trip, and then just hope you're the best today.
You know, word from Churchill has been that he's been training exceptionally well. Do you see a major change in him from what you saw this winter in Palm Meadows?
Yes. When we got off the plane Thursday, we went over there, and you can just see that he's a big, you know, he looks bigger to me. You know, he's definitely still carrying his weight very well, which is important, especially in a race like this. His coat is unbelievably good, you know. He's just very alert and chipper. And, I mean, not that he wasn't in Palm Meadows, but he's really sort of picked his game up, it looks like. And I don't know if it's the combination of the cooler weather here. That's probably a part of it for all the horses. But just seeing him on the track, he has such bounce to himself, and he's just doing unbelievable. So.
Well, we're about to take a look at his last start, the Louisiana Derby, and for our audience, he's number one. Donnie, let's talk about some factors in here, you know, which led to this somewhat disappointing second. First of all, it looked like his style was changed somewhat because, you know, of the pace scenario. I mean, he doesn't usually run this close to the pace. How accurate is that?
That's very accurate. We were told that, you know, there wasn't going to be much pace in the race, and that speed was starting to carry later in the card. So they did an audible, and they changed and said, you know, you got to be laying a little closer. So, you know, that's what he did. And then the other thing was he was down inside and couldn't really get off the rail at any juncture until they, you know, sort of straightened out in the stretch. And on the far turn, he did, you know, get whacked around a little bit. I think it was by a three horse, or I'm not sure. But and then the big thing with him was that he wasn't switching leads. And in the middle of the stretch, he actually, you know, bears into the rail when Mike tried to whack him to get him to switch leads over. It caught him off guard a little bit. But as Mike pointed out, Vickers in Trouble got away with a very soft pace that day, and it wouldn't have really mattered. By the time we cleared, we weren't going to catch him on that day.
Now, Donnie, I assume with the big field and the likely legitimate pace later this afternoon in the Derby, that we can expect Intense Holiday to be much farther off the early pace.
Oh, that's for sure. I mean, the one blessing of having the outside post, you know, out towards the end there is the fact that Johnny will be able to break, hopefully, and be able to look over to his left and see where he wants to put him in position. Unless Todd changes something, you know, during the afternoon, this is the type of race where he should try to make his one big run.
And the post should actually help him, considering he doesn't like to race inside of horses. Post should be pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, he'll probably, you know, as usual, he'll have probably a 2-3-4 pass. In this race, it could be a little wider because of the amount of horses in the race. But he'll definitely should be in a position where he gets a clear run when he's able to make that. The first turn is critical.
Now, Donnie, you also recently purchased General A-Rod. You've got a part of him from a private sale. Now, Starlight usually purchases their horses through, you know, the sales, not private sales. Why the private purchase of General A-Rod?
Well, we have a partner. His name is James Shercliffe. He's from Kentucky, and he brought it to our attention back in January, you know, about this horse. He has horses with Michael Maker, and, you know, was poking around on the horse after the Gulfstream Park Derby, I believe, is where the horse was so impressive and won. And so we tried to actually secure this horse back in January before the Holy Bull, knowing that he was running in the Fountain of Youth and then most likely the Florida Derby. We were unable to do that and come to terms. You know, the gentleman that owned them just felt that, you know, he was going to win both of those races. just like all of us, we have dreams, then, you know, go into the Derby as the favorite. And, you know, that didn't occur. And then the beginning of the week, I don't remember the day or over the weekend, last weekend, he had a sort of a subpar work. And there were reasons for that. And, you know, we had checked him out and looked into it. And so we had a hold of Mike Maker, verified a few things. Then Mr. Shercliffe revived the conversations. And we were able to secure him Sunday night and make the deal happen Monday morning. And his works since then, with blinkers on and, you know, an adjustment here and there, have proven well. So, you know, he has the perfect post for his running style, being in the eighth position. He'll be definitely a lot closer to the pace, probably one of the first horses to challenge the leaders, hopefully, on the far turn.
And finally, Donnie, before we let you go, 8 days ago it was announced that your Ashado had been elected to Racing's Hall of Fame. What does that honor mean to you?
Well, I wasn't actually a part of that horse. You know, Jack, though, it's very dear to them. I mean, I was at the races for them, but at the time we hadn't sold our business yet. So, you know, I was just sort of a supporter, but I know how dear it is to the Wolves, you know, what it means to them. I think it's the second or third time they've, you know, attempted, and they sort of thought they'd be in on the first time. And that filly is such a class filly. I mean, it's amazing, you know, what she accomplished. And it'll be a big day coming in August. We'll all be there in support.
Well, Donnie, as always, thank you so much for your time. Thanks so much for having joined us this morning on Down the Stretch. Enjoy your Derby day. The walk over with Intense Holiday should be really one of the highlights. We'll hope for a clean trip and a good run from him. We'll wish you all the best, and we'll talk to you again soon.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Don. Donnie Lucarelli, ladies and gentlemen. And we are up to our next break. When we return, Billy Gowan will join us as we go to this break. The 1987 Kentucky Derby and the 2-1 favorite, Demons Be Gone. So we'll take a look at the 87 Derby to the break. Back with Billy Gowan right after these messages.
Between horses. Now there goes Leo Castelli on the inside, though Capote grabs the early lead past the stands for the first time. From between horses on the line, charging up to get command. Capote along the inside is second, and on the outside, that's Candy's Gold Racing third. In the middle of the track, No More Powers up fourth. Bet Twice is fifth. Masterful Advocate from between horses sixth. There goes Leo Castelli bullying his way between horses seventh. Masterful Advocate, in fact, almost went out. War is in trouble on the inside, around the first turn. Capote leads it by a length. Stablemate on the line into second position by two. Candy's Gold on the outside, third by a head. Along the inside, that's Leo Castelli with Jacinto Vasquez in the irons in fourth position. War regaining on the inside now fifth. Bet Twice is sixth. Masterful Advocate is seventh. No More Flowers on the outside is racing eighth. Templar Hill moving through along the inside ninth. Softlit One is tenth. No More Flowers back to 11th. After that, it's Ali Sheba, Momentous, Crypto Clearance, Between Horses, Gulch is far back. On the outside, Conquista Rose is 16th. And the favorite, Demons Be Gone, is 17th and last. He's pulling up around the far turn on the inside. It's on the line, but on the outside. There goes Bet Twice. Bet Twice to the front, way ahead with Craig Coretta aboard. On the inside, that's on the line with Gary Stevens hanging tough as they turn for home a quarter of a mile to go. Bet Twice taking the lead by one. On the outside, here comes Ali Sheba. On the line, dropping out of it. Middle of the racetrack, Crypto Clearance with Jose Santos is flying. Leo Castelli between horses. And down the stretch they come. Bet Twice on the inside, leads it by a head. On the outside, here comes Ali Sheba. Ali Sheba with Chris McGarrett to the front. Bet Twice. race back to second. Here's the finish. Ali Sheba wins it by 3/4 of a length. On the inside, Beth Price finishing second. Havies Company with Mickey Salamone, part of the neutral field, finishing third.
This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
The big day is here. You've told everybody. You've dressed the part. Your heart is pounding in your chest. Your horse is rolling down the stretch. He's coming. He's closing. He's the winner. You're a winner with Parting Glass Racing. PartingGlassRacing.com. PartingGlassRacing.wow.
Welcome back to Down the Stretch, everyone. I'm Mark Cassano. My thanks to Don Lucarelli once again for having joined us, and Ali Sheba for Jack Van Berg and Chris McCarron. Despite almost going down in the stretch, runs down Bet Twice by an expanding 3/4 of a length to win the 1987 Derby. Our final guest this morning has really overcome tremendous odds to have a runner in this year's Kentucky Derby. Considering that he has only, and he's up to 4 horses in the barn, he's got a runner in the Derby and ride On Curlin. We welcome in live via telephone from Louisville, Mr. Billy Gowan. Billy, Mark Cassano welcoming you back to Down the Stretch.
Thanks for having me.
Billy, nice to have you. How do you feel here on Derby morning knowing that you're going to be part of America's greatest race?
Oh, it's the greatest feeling in the world. That's what we get up every morning to try to accomplish, and we made it here, so we got one last goal, and that'd be to drape the roses over him.
I mean, is it a feeling of nervousness, excitement? Give us an idea what your emotions are this morning.
Well, it's just more of excitement than anything. There's no reason to be nervous because we got the horse back in the stall and he sounds. So I'm looking forward to running the race. It's really exciting. And the main thing is my horse is just doing so good. So that's what I'm pleased about more than anything.
Well, we are about to take a look at how Ride On Curlin got to Louisville. His last start, the Arkansas Derby. For our audience, Ride On Curlin, number 4 in here. Billy, talk to our audience about this fine runner-up effort.
Well, he did. He ran a huge race that day. John Court rode him really well. We had to go a tick wide around the turn. May have cost us a little bit. You know, you got to tip your hat to Dan, though. He's a nice horse, and I've been watching him all week, and he's training good, too. So, we got beat by a nice horse, but my horse, I think, is on the improve all the time. He seems to come out of his race better than he went in them. And the same out of the Arkansas Derby going into this one. He's thrived since he's gotten here, and so I'm happy with the way he's going.
You know, Billy, we had you on the show the morning of the Rebel, and one of the things we discussed that morning is you were hoping that Kent DeSormo would be able to get him off the pace, more of a stalking position. But in that race, you were caught inside on the worst part of the racetrack on the pace. How important was it that John Court was able to get your colt off the pace here in the Arkansas Derby?
Well, it's very important. It's very important today also. You know, when he ran into Champaign up in New York, we were probably 10 lengths off the pace, and he came flying and ran a huge race, just 2 nice horses. So that definitely is going to be his best running style, is coming off the pace and having something to run at. And the way I see it, it looks like it's going to be a pretty hot pace today, and hopefully we can, you know, save ground as much as possible and come running at the end.
Now, you know, everyone knows Calvin Burrell for saving ground. His nickname is Burrell, but you obviously don't have the ideal post position this afternoon. Will you have any specific instructions for Calvin?
Well, I think he and I both discussed it, and hopefully, you know, we got almost 3/8 of a mile to get over going into that first turn, so I think we'll have plenty of time to get over, and he can just sit out there and watch how unfolded and kind of inches way over to the rail. I think we'll be in good shape as far as getting to the rail.
As far as coming out of the Arkansas Derby and how he's been training, how's Ride On Curlin been doing the last 3 weeks?
He has trained as good as anybody could want him to. I tell you, I wouldn't change a thing about the way he's trained. He's just good. He's real good right now. He's mentally, he's sharp, and he's real sound. So I think I'm sitting perfect.
Have you given yourself the leeway to think about what it would mean to you to win the Kentucky Derby?
Oh, I thought about it before. I told somebody I might have to retire because I don't think you could top that, you know?
Well, Billy, look, at congratulations, because I think it is absolutely amazing, because let's face it, you had a three-horse stable for a while. Now it's up to four, and you've got a starter in the greatest race in the world. So congratulations there. Congratulations with all the successes with Ride On Curlin. Enjoy your Derby day, and we wish you the best.
I appreciate you. Appreciate that, and appreciate you having me on.
Thank you, Billy. Billy Gowan, ladies and gentlemen. Folks, this truly is an amazing story. You know, Todd Pletcher's got four in the Derby. We know how expansive his barn is. Mike Maker's got three in the Derby. That's terrific. But this young man, Bronco Billy Gowan, has had all of three horses in the barn, and he's got a colt with a legitimate outside chance in this afternoon's 140th Kentucky Derby. And we are up to our next break when we return analysis of this afternoon's Derby. As we go to the break, the year was 1986. And of all the Derbies I have handicapped professionally, and, you know, we're talking about approximately 30, this was actually the easiest one to determine the pace scenario. With Groovy and Zabaleta adding blinkers and Bachelor Bow and Snow Chief, I was not only convinced that there was going to be a lively pace, a very fast pace, but I was pretty much convinced that there was a legitimate chance for a pace meltdown. So we are going to take a look at the 86 Derby to the break, back with a look at this afternoon's Kentucky Derby right after these messages.
And they're up. Racing for the lead from the outside, Bachelor Bow and Groovy. Also from the outside, Zabaleta, Snow Chief, between horses, then Vernon Castle. Down the stretch for the first time, Groovy has the lead by a length. Zabaleta is second, Bachelor Bow third, a length to Snow Chief fourth. Gap of four, Vernon Castle, fifth, five ahead, seven to field, six to half, Mike Broad Rush is seven. Three horses meet the all round to eight. Up from the outside, Badger Land is ninth. And on to the back stretch, it's Groovy by a length. Zabaleta second, length and a half. Bachelor Bow third ahead, Snow Chief fourth, gap of five. Southern Appeal now runs fifth. Length of Broad Brush in sixth. Wheatley Hall seventh by ahead. Vernon Castle eighth. Three lengths of Badgerland running ninth. Down on the inside, Rampage ten. Bowl arrangement is 11. Also from the inside, that's Wise Time. They're moving for their turn. Groovy on the inside has a head in front. Zabaleta second of length. No, Chief is gaining ground. Those three are right together. Bachelor Bow fourth. Into the turn. Zabaleta head in front. Snow Chief second. Gap of two. From the inside, Wheatley Hall third ahead. Broad Rush fourth ahead. Badger Land on the extreme outside. They're moving for the stretch. Snow Chief, Broad Rush on the outside. Badger Land, all three horses together. Also gaining ground, that's Bold Arrangement. They're into the stretch. Badger Land on the outside. On the inside, Bold Arrangement. Here comes Bird Man on the rail. In the final furlong, it's Bird Man gets the lead. On the outside, Bold Arrangement and Broad Rush. Nearing the wire, it's Bird Man in front. On the outside, Bold Arrangement. On the outside, Bird Man and the Bill Shoemaker wins the Derby by two. Broad Rush finishes second, a photo.
This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Funding your Capital OTB bet account is as easy as 1, 2, 3. 1, easy money. Clearly the fastest and easiest method of depositing funds into your account. Make deposits or withdrawals in just minutes. 2, Green Dot Money Pack. Gives you instant access to your funds. Green Dot Money Packs are available at thousands of retailers nationwide. And 3, MasterCard Visa. Simply click on the link from the funding page, enter your account information, and fund your account. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today.
Welcome back to Down the Stretch, everyone. I'm Mark Asano. My thanks to Billy Gowan once again for having joined us, and Ferdinand. For all-time greats, Charlie Whittingham and Bill Shoemaker overcame the inside post. You know, the field spread out so much because of the very fast pace. And the shoe picked his way through and scored at 17-1 by 2.25 lengths over bold arrangement in broad brush 28 years ago. All right, time to take a look at the field for this afternoon's 140th renewal of America's greatest race, the Kentucky Derby. Number one is Vickers in Trouble. Trained by Mike Maker, one of three he's gotten here, Rosie Napravnik rides. Very impressive winner, the LeCompte three back. Did not run so well in the Risen Star, but they took him out of his normal running style from a difficult post, came back in the Louisiana Derby to wire the field. Now, you're looking at the morning line odds. I will give you the odds overnight. There's been about 203,000 bet in the win pool. Vickers in Trouble, 21-1. Number two is Harry's Holiday, also for Mike Maker. Corey Lannery in his first Derby. You know, two back, he actually ran the best race of anybody in the Spiral, got beat a nose, ran 13th of 14 in the Bluegrass and last. And you know what? There's really nothing to recommend Harry's Holiday this afternoon. Number three is Uncle Cy, one of the two New York breds in here. Gary Contessa trains. Rod Ortiz Jr. will be up. Gary adding blinkers after the colt missed the break in the Wood Memorial. Now, he ran well to be second behind Samrat in both the Withers and the Gotham. He is 22-1 overnight. Number four is Danza, one of four in here for Todd Pletcher. Joe Bravo rides. We are about to take a look at Danza in the Arkansas Derby. He is getting through on the fence. Folks, he was 41-1 in here. He's going to win like he should have been 4-5. I don't know where this effort came from. He had started once at Gulfstream Park in an entry-level allowance, ran a little bit wide, and got beat 7.5 lengths. So he moved forward tremendously, obviously, from that entry-level allowance sprint to here in the Arkansas Derby. But I don't know what it means. It's hard for me to fathom that kind of an effort off the sprint race he ran. He's been training well. He's also the co-second choice at 8-1 overnight. On to number five, the favorite, California Chrome. Art Sherman trains, Victor Espinoza rides. Here is California Chrome en route to winning the Santa Anita Derby. He was able to comfortably stalk on the outside, take over and draw clear to a very easy 5.25 length win. He has gone from strength to strength to strength. He has won his last four starts. Folks, this is an amazing story because when we turn the calendar to 2014, California Chrome was nothing more than the answer to the following trivia question. Who won the last stakes race in the history of Hollywood Park? In fact, when he ran in the Cal Cup Derby against restricted Calbreds, he wasn't even the favorite. But his wins in the San Felipe and the Santa Anita Derby have been visually outstanding. Art Sherman later this afternoon will bid to become the oldest winning trainer in the Kentucky Derby. It was 59 years ago that Art went to Louisville accompanying the Great Swaps. Victor Espinoza has a Derby victory with War Emblem. California Chrome is 3-1 overnight. Number six is Samrat. The other New York bred, Rick Violet trains, Jose Ortiz will ride. Samrat, a winner of 5 of 6, his only defeat in the Wood Memorial when he ran second. He is a colt who tends to lean on horses because he's got some trouble changing leads. But I think this is a very, very good post for him. I don't know if he's good enough, but I think he may sit a very good trip from this post, and he is 18-1 overnight. Number seven is We Miss Artie. Todd Pletcher trains, Javier Castellano rides. His late running victory in the Spiral gave him enough points to get into the Derby. His dirt form is really questionable. He was eighth in the Fountain of Youth, beaten 17, and granted, that's Gulfstream, and there are horses that just don't like Gulfstream. You know, he was seventh in last year's Breeders' Cup Juvenile. Earlier this week, We Miss Artie didn't work particularly well. I don't think Todd was too big on running him today, but owner Ken Ramsey wanted to run. And We Miss Artie is only 22-1 overnight. Number eight is General A-Rod. Third starter for Mike Maker, Joel Rosario, who won last year's Derby with Orb as a board. Very, very, very consistent colt. He won the Gulfstream Park Derby with a perfect outside trip. Then he pressed Wildcat Red every step of the way when beaten ahead in the Fountain of Youth. You know, in the Florida Derby, flattened out a little bit late. The big question, you know, as is the question for all of them, 10 furlongs. But he is 27-1 overnight. It's a little hard to believe. He's actually 5 points higher than We Miss Artie, you know, who doesn't show much dirt form. On to number nine, Vince Ramos. Again, Todd Pletcher. Joe Rocco Jr. will ride. Winner of the Sam Davis was second behind Runaway Ring Weekend in the Tampa Bay Derby. They tried a synthetic experiment in the bluegrass, and he didn't beat a horse. I think he's obviously going to prefer the return to dirt. And as far as monster long shots go, and he is going to be one of the longest prices, he's got a little bit of a shot to outrun his odds. He's 38-1 overnight. Number 10 is Wildcat Red. Jose Garofalo trains, Luis Saez will ride. 7 lifetime starts. Never been worse than a close second. Was probably best in the Gulfstream Park Derby, where he got beat ahead, but he was under pressure every step of the way from the inside post. He jogged in the Hutchison, then went wire to wire under pressure every step of the way in the Fountain of Youth. And in the Florida Derby, he set his own pace only to get outfinished by Constitution, who came inside of him. I am a very big fan of Wildcat Red. I think he is a game, gutsy, courageous colt. But I don't like him this afternoon. I just can't see him getting a mile and a quarter on this racetrack. He is 14-1 overnight. Now the second half of the field, and of course we begin this with the scratch of number 11, Opportunity, who again would have been my top choice. On to number 12, Dance with Fate. Peter Urton trains, Corey Nakatani will ride. Here is Dance with Fate, rallying widest of all to capture the bluegrass on synthetic at Keeneland in last. He will outfinish Metal Count, who ran a very good second. Now, Peter Urton admits that Dance with Fate prefers synthetic and he prefers time between races. He had a lot of time between the El Camino Real and this victory in the bluegrass. Well, Dance with Fate is going to get neither his preferred surface or time between races for this afternoon's Kentucky Derby. But all indications are that he's training very well. And you know, last year in the Grade 1 front runner, now listen, this was a pretty weak Grade 1, but he ran second, and that was on dirt at Santa Anita. He did run poorly in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile, but that was such a quirky racetrack that day that a lot of horses didn't run well. This could be an interesting horse. He is 14-1 overnight. On to number 13, Chitu. Bob Baffert's only Derby runner now, Martin Garcia will ride. A very solid second in his two-turn debut, two back, in the Robert Lewis behind Candy Boy. Then he won the Sunland Derby, shaking off constant pressure from Midnight Hawk. Now, he's the son of Henny Hughes, and, you know, Henny Hughes doesn't scream a mile and a quarter. But this little guy is tenacious. He will likely be a pace factor, and he is 25-1 overnight. Number 14 is Medal Count. Dale Roman's trains, Robbie Alvarado, will ride. The Derby will be the third race in 29 days for the son of Dynaformer. He had won the Transylvanian off the turf race, came back 8 days later, and ran a fine second in the Bluegrass. You know, he ran fifth, beaten nine in the Fountain of Youth, but that was an okay race at Gulfstream. He's another, along with Dance with Fate, who is kind of fascinating. He is 17-1 overnight. Number 15 is Tapator. Steve Asmussen trains, Ricardo Santana Jr. will ride. An impressive winner of the Southwest three-back, a good solid second in the roughly run Rebel two-back, but in the Arkansas Derby and last, he was empty. That was a major step backwards. Now, if there was a legitimate excuse for that effort, then Tapature could surprise a lot of people this afternoon. He's a horse who prefers racing outside, so his, you know, post should be somewhat helpful as far as that goes. He is 27-1 overnight. Number 16 is Intense Holiday. Todd Pletcher trains. Johnny Velasquez, who won the Derby a few years back on Animal Kingdom rides. We are about to take a look at Intense Holiday rally from far back to win the Risen Star two back. Folks, this is his normal running style. Now, other than Hopportunity and Vickers in Trouble, Hopportunity did not run particularly well in this race. This was kind of second-level competition. But Albano was loose on the lead, had set very conservative fractions, and Intense Holiday stormed down the long fairground stretch to nail him. And considering the pace scenario, I thought this was impressive. The Louisiana Derby raced closer to the pace, didn't like being inside. He's 13-1 overnight. Number 17 is Commanding Curve. Dallas Stewart, who ran second in last year's Derby as the trainer, Sean Bridgemahan will ride. Only two starts this year. He needed the Risen Star when he was sixth. I liked him as a long shot in the Louisiana Derby, where he ran third after not breaking well. You know, the 50-1 morning line price was ridiculous. He's half of that overnight. And if he moves forward off that Louisiana Derby, he could surprise some people. On to number 18, Candy Boy. John Sadler trains, Gary Stevens will ride. Second in last year's Cash Call Futurity for his two-year-old finale. Won the Robert Lewis, then was a very distant third in the Santa Anita Derby when he was taken out of his normal running style. Gary Stevens, who has won the Derby three times, is up, and Candy Boy is 16-1 overnight. Number 19 is Ride On Curlin. Billy Gowan trains. Three-time Derby winner Calvin Burrell is up. A sneaky good third in the Rebel two-back, and a rallying second in the Arkansas Derby in last. You heard Billy Gowan say it's important to get him off the pace. He'll obviously be off the pace this afternoon. He's only 12-1 overnight. And rounding out the 19-horse field, number 20, Wicked Strong. Jimmy Jerkins trains. Rajiv Marah is up. We're about to take a look at Wicked Strong rally on the outside to capture and upset the Wood Memorial. You know, Wicked Strong has raced well around two turns at Aqueduct. He was a very good and close third in last year's Remsen. Here you're watching him rally to win the Wood Memorial. His two races in Florida, although he trained well at Palm Meadows, were dreadful. He was ninth in the Holy Bull. The entry-level allowance race wasn't so bad, but he was a distant fourth there. You know, this is a horse who is coming to hand. Jimmy Jerkins took a piece of old-fashioned training earlier this week on Thursday. He blew out Wicked Strong, 3 furlongs and 30, 6 4/5. So there is a look at the 19-horse field for this afternoon's 140th renewal of the Kentucky Derby. Approximate post time, 6:24. And by the way, in case I didn't say this, overnight, Wicked Strong is the co-second choice at 8-1. And we are up to our final break. When we return, my selections for this afternoon's Derby. As we go to this final break, you know, we've been changing the Derbies this morning that we've shown to the internal breaks. Not going to change this one. 1973 and perfection. Enjoy it. So we'll take a look at Big Red going to the break. Back with my selections right after these messages.
Under on for the lead. On the inside, that's Angolite for the lead. On the outside, Shecky Green, Royal and Regal. Then on the rail, it's Restless Jet, followed by Our Native. Up on the outside is Gold Bag. They're by the stands for the first time. Shecky Green is showing the way by a length and a half. Royal and Regal now being moved to the inside, looking for room. Gold Bag is up on the outside. Then on the rail, it's Angolite, followed by Sham, Our Native, Restless Jet. It's My Gallant, then Forgo. On the outside, Navajo, followed by Secretariat, Warbucks, and finally, Twice a Prince. They're moving on the turn. The leader is Shecky Green, leading by 2.5 lengths. Gold Bag is second by a head. Sham now third on the outside by 2 lengths. Royal and Regal fourth, 2 lengths then back to Angolite in fifth. The Secretariat has made a sudden move and is now sixth. Then it's Restless Jet, Our Native beginning to move up. Navajo, Forgo, and Warbucks beginning to move up, followed by My Gallant and Twice a Prince. They're into the turn and bunching for the lead with Shecky Green, still the leader by 0.5 length. On the outside and challenging is Sham, and he's now got a head in front. Now Shecky Green responds to the challenge, and those two are heads apart. Royal and Regal is third and holding on. Gold Bag drops back. Secretariat is fourth and moving up on the outside and is now third and moving at the leaders as they come for the head of the stretch. They're at the head of the stretch and Sham is the leader. He leads it by a length. Secretariat is in the center of the racetrack and driving. Shecky Green now drops back. Coming on a bit is Forgo, Our Native on the outside. Now and they're in the stretch. It's Secretariat. Secretariat on the outside to take the lead. Sham holding in second. It's Secretariat moving away. He has it by 2.5. Sham, then on the outside, Our Native. At the wire, it's going to be Secretariat. He wins it by 2 lengths. Sham is second. Our Native third by a neck. Forgo is fourth. Restless Jet is fifth. And it looked like Navajo might have gotten up for sixth.
This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Welcome back to Down the Stretch, everyone. I'm Mark Cassano. I hope you enjoyed looking back at Big Red in 1973. You didn't think I was going to leave that one out, did you? All right, time for selections for this afternoon's Kentucky Derby. And with Opportunity out, who would have been my top choice, I liked him quite a bit. I thought he was sitting on a big race. My selection to win the 140th Kentucky Derby with some trepidation is number 5, California Chrome. The trepidation comes from his post position, post 5, which is far from ideal, and his recent behavior in the gate. Now, I'll take the latter point first. In both the San Felipe and the Santa Anita Derby, California Chrome got quite fidgety in the gate. Now, he actually caught a flyer in the San Felipe, but in the Santa Anita Derby, he missed the break slightly. You know, if he doesn't break alertly today from an inside post, he's likely in trouble. But if he breaks cleanly and Victor Espinoza can negotiate a good trip, I believe California Chrome is best. He has outstanding rateable speed, which is a great commodity. I would have liked him far more from an outside post, but I'll still give him the call nonetheless in this afternoon's Derby. My second choice goes to number 18, Candy Boy, who should be a very square price off his lackluster third, beaten nearly nine lengths by California Chrome in the Santa Anita Derby and last. Even outstanding trainers and jockeys make mistakes, and I believe John Sadler and Gary Stevens made the mistake of trying to change a horse's racing style when they strategized that Candy Boy needed to be much closer to the pace in the Santa Anita Derby, and he simply ran poorly. But today, they can let the son of Candy Ride return to his optimum running style, settling off the pace and saving a run for late. And with Gary Stevens, a three-time Derby winner aboard, you are likely to get the best trip you can from Candy Boy. You know, whether he's good enough or not, you'll have to see. But I think we'll get a great ride from Gary Stevens. You know, his two-year-old finale in the Hollywood Futurity still resonates with me. That was when he made a premature but very impressive backstretch long run, which took him from 10th early to the front around the far turn. He's obviously got a run in him. Stevens is going to have to time it well this afternoon. My third choice is number 20, Wicked Strong. Despite the fact that his trainer, Jimmy Jerkins, received a text from Hall of Fame rider Edgar Prado saying that post 20 was perfect, you know, I don't think it is. Rajiv Marau will somehow have to work out a trip from the extreme outside. In addition, there are extraneous potential problems with Wicked Strong. You know, sometimes the crowd gets him stirred up, so you're going to have to pay attention to that. But he is a talented colt who's coming into the race very, very well. And my fourth choice goes to Intense Holiday. Like Wicked Strong, he's been training particularly well at Churchill. And like his rival, you know, didn't relish racing over that very biased surface at Gulfstream. Despite the somewhat softer competition, I was impressed by Intense Holiday's off-the-pace win in the Risen Star. Two back, you know, because the early pace was very conservative. Louisiana Derby, he raced inside, which he doesn't like, and I think he raced too close to the pace. Johnny Velasquez can save his run for the stretch run. So recapping my selections for the 140th Kentucky Derby, California Chrome. A lot of history on the line. If Art Sherman wins it, he becomes the oldest winning trainer, surpassing Charlie Whittingham. Candy Boy, my second choice. Wicked Strong, third. And Intense Holiday, fourth. Now, quickly, because we know California Chrome will be the favorite, you know, let's take a look. Normally, you don't get any value on favorites, but that's not the case in the Derby because of field size. Here's a look over the last 10 years at the Derby favorites and what their off odds were. So with these large size fields, the average Derby favorite over the last 10 years is just a dime shy of 4.5 to 1. Now, I don't think California Chrome will be quite that high this afternoon. And one of the reasons why is, you know, Churchill increased takeout by about, what, 9.25 or 9.3%. But you do get some value in looking at that chart, even liking favorites in the Kentucky Derby. All right, time to wrap things up and time to thank all the folks who got this week's show on the air. Here at the studios of the Clubhouse Racebook in Albany, our associate producer Julie Hoxie, Brian Dorenzo, and Mick Richards. Back in the control room in Schenectady, Pat Peretta directed, Dan Hayes on audio. Thanks to our guests this morning, Donnie Lucarelli and Billy Gowan. We wish them both a lot of luck. And thanks to our sponsor, Parting Glass Racing, Saratoga's original racing partnership. Visit them on the web at partingglassracing.com. Ladies and gentlemen, as always, thank you so very much for having joined us this morning on Down the Stretch. Enjoy the Kentucky Derby. Let's hope for a safe one. Have a wonderful upcoming week. And from all of us here at Down the Stretch, we'll see you next week.
You're watching OTB TV, a service of Capital Off-Track Betting.